Right, sir, based on your analysis, why are most of these illegal operators concentrated in Central Luzon and in Metro Manila?
Okay. The primary enabling factor, so to speak, would be their proximity to urban areas with high-speed internet connectivity. That's one. Second is their proximity to the international airports and other transportation facilities that allows them mobility. So what you have in Central Luzon is basically the class international airport that provides them an almost daily access in and out of Central Luzon. Now, that's very crucial to them. That allows them to bring in their foreign workers, and likewise, that allows them an exit point when the going gets tough for them. And so does Metro Manila. So these are pretty good enabling factors that allows them to, that pushes them towards this particular two locations.
All right. Sir, we saw yesterday that the president received a standing ovation from legislators and other guests in the Batasang Pambansa when he announced that he is banning all POGOs in the Philippines. How does this clear directive now affect the PAOK's operations against offshore gaming operators in the Philippines?
Well, it affects us positively, beneficially, because now we've got a much better directive, much clearer directive, I mean, that would impel not only the commission, but the other agencies of government to support our drive against these POGOs. But mind you, Katrina, way before the presidential directive yesterday with the SONA, the president through the executive secretary has already given us a presidential directive to be able to go against this rogue POGOs. So this is not new to us, but what it basically means for us yesterday is that this would provide us the necessary support we require from the different agencies of government.
Mm-hmm. With this kind of support coming from the president, do you expect a hike in your budget for under the 2025 national budget? Because as we all know, next week, the DBM is set to submit the NEP to the Congress.
Well, that's something for the policymakers to decide. That's way above my pay grade. But of course, it's on our wish list, of course.
So far, how much does the PAOK have for it to operate?
Well, that is a confidential matter that I'd like to keep to within the agency, Katrina. I hope you don't mind.
Yes, I don't mind, sir. But I also hope you don't mind me asking, how much do you actually need for you to improve your operations against these rogue POGOs?
Well, let's look at it this way. A four-month operation against a POGO operation with the size of Porac and Bamban costs the commission around 35 million pesos on a four-month period. That would involve from the case build-up, basically the pre-operation phase, all the way to the deportation phase. But let me qualify, now that the People's Republic of China is handling the deportation costs of the foreign nationals, that is a significant, that would significantly decrease the amount we need for every operation against POGO hubs. But of course, smaller POGO farms, say you've got a 2,000 square meter POGO farm, would require a much lower amount for us.
All right, sir, let's talk about Lin Kide. Did I pronounce his name correctly? This is the 40-year-old hacker recently arrested in La Union.
Yes, ma'am.
Lin, how do you pronounce his name again?
I likewise have a great difficulty pronouncing his name. Let us just say that the Chinese hacker we caught in La Union.
Or let's just call him Mr. Lin. Okay,
yes, ma'am.
Let's talk about Mr. Lin here. What do we know about him so far? So far, the Bureau of Immigration says that he is a 40-year-old fugitive. He is wanted in other countries. He is a 40-year-old hacker who was arrested in La Union. What other information can you provide about Mr. Lin so far?
Yeah. The Bureau of Immigration and PAOK have been running after the fugitives who were able to escape from Bamban and Porac. And we've got a good number of mission orders and search warrants, arrest warrants, that we need to serve against these foreign individuals. And one of them is Mr. Lin. Mr. Lin is a fugitive from the People's Republic of China. He's got an arrest warrant that was shared to the immigration and to the commission by the People's Republic of China police attaché. Now, over the weekend, I think that was late Friday, we got information that Mr. Lin, together with a good number of foreign nationals, Chinese nationals, are trying to set up a new POGO operations in La Union, in one of the high-end resorts of La Union. So, armed with a mission order, the Bureau of Immigration, with assistance of the Commission, with assistance of PAOK, went to La Union, San Fernando, La Union, if I'm not mistaken, and interviewed, did a welfare check of all of the foreign nationals that they found in that particular resort. And then, incidentally, during the service of the mission order, during implementation of the mission order, we found that Mr. Lin didn't have his proper documents with him. And more than that, he had an outstanding warrant from the People's Republic of China. So we got him to we brought him to Manila. He's now at the Bikutan. And with the assistance of his counsel, he will be subjected to an interview in the next few days to be able to ascertain his criminal liability in Philippine jurisdiction.
And I believe that he was found hiding in a luxury villa resort in Poro Point in Freeport, La Union. Should the government actually impose sanctions to some accommodations or other establishments that would house certain individuals who may be linked to POGOs?
For one, we'd like to call on all of these facilities, hotel industries, tourism facilities in areas that are within export processing zones, free ports and the like. We'd hope that they do more due diligence in accepting clients such as Mr. Lin. Now, second is we do hope that the banning of the POGOs that the president made mention last night would not only cover those areas outside the export processing zones. Remember, Katrina, that POGOs, before they became normal outside within Metro Manila and other places of Luzon, they were already operating way back 2003 in areas controlled by the Philippine Export Zone Authority, PEZA. So they're all over. They've been all over the country in all of these export processing zone areas. So we do hope that the total banning of this offshore gaming would not only cover PAGCO-related sites, but likewise cover all of those areas in these export processing zones.
And Winston, do you expect the president's statement during his SONA yesterday to actually be enough to discourage syndicates from operating in the Philippines and actually push them to finally pack their bags and find another haven for their illegal activities?
Well, this would be enough for a chilling effect for those who are not sophisticated, for those POGO farms that are not run by sophisticated criminal agencies. The typical money launderers would find it difficult to operate now in the Philippines, and I'm sure most of them would pack their bags. But those others who are supported, enabled by foreign transnational organized crime syndicates, I wouldn't presume that they would simply pack their bags and go. They really need to be located, identified, apprehended, incarcerated, and then deported. So we've got our work cut out for us, but I'm pretty confident that with the help of the Philippine National Police and the National Bureau of Investigation, Department of Justice, the AMLs, and the other agencies, we'll get them and we'll be able to neutralize them given the time period that the president gave us, which is until the end of the year.
Winston, while the president's anti-POGO policy is much lauded by the public and lawmakers so far, we are not sure if this similar stance will be retained by future administrations. So what laws should be passed to make this anti-POGO stance more permanent and more insulated from political headwinds?
Well, technically, no amount of law would be able to put an end to this problem if a new administration comes in, because they can simply repeal that law, right? But what we need now is basically a better understanding for the general public, for the other members of government going down to the local government to simply put out a total ban resolution, right, in their respective localities to make sure that this particular offshore gaming operations do not go back, do not come back, that it won't resuscitate itself in the next administration. Then again, it's too far off. We're not even into the midterm. So let's wait and see.
As the administration calls it, a whole-of-government approach. With that, thank you so much for joining us this morning, PAOK spokesperson Winston Casho.
Thank you, Katrina. Bye.